So anyways, before we get into me actually like introducing you to the setup and also giving you guys tutorials of how I use the stuff that I do to make my videos, I just want to thank you guys so much for the amount of support that I've gotten. That took a lot of breath out of me. But everything that you guys have seen in this video and will see in this video, I would not have if it, you know, hadn't been for you guys, if I hadn't started this channel and you guys subscribed to it and watch my videos and stuff like that. Ever since I stopped doing, you know, Clash of Clans and that sort of stuff, I've been growing and it's been really healthy for my channel, and I've just found a lot of motivation to continue to do all this fun stuff for you guys. And one thing that you guys don't really know is like how much work and how much effort goes into these videos, and that's the reason why they don't come out daily. If they did come out daily, there'd be like no editing, there'd just be a voiceover, you know, maybe some music in the background and the gameplay, and that'd be it. But I do so much more than that. You guys are gonna see that in a second here, because I like to produce good content for you guys. So once again, guys, thank you so much for the amount of support. Let's keep going. 5,000 is it's a little ways away, but we're gonna get there eventually, and I can't thank you guys enough for that. Also, the channel has gotten some new channel art. Let me know what you guys think about that. I made all that art a couple of days ago, and I don't know, I definitely like it, and I want to hear your guys' opinions on it. So let me know what you think about the new channel art. Do you like the old stuff or the new stuff? The old profile picture had like a Clash of Clans Electro Wizard in it, and I kind of wanted to get rid of that because it's not unique to me, it's not my own creation or anything like that, and I could get copyright stricken by Supercell or something like that. But I don't want to run into that, so I just completely made my own stuff. So yeah, let me know what you guys think. But anyways, let's get into the setup tour and the tutorials. Alright guys, so here's the setup. I hope you guys like it. I cleaned it up for you, made it look a little nice for you. I hope you guys like the way this is. This is a cheap setup, like I told you guys before many times. But anyway, starting off, to record my videos, I use a jack splitter so I can listen to my headphones, and then it plugs into an auxiliary cord, which also plugs into the computer that you guys can see right there. And then on the computer, I have software called Audacity, which is what I use to record game sound. What I hear in my headphones is what Audacity is going to read off of that aux cord as well. To record my sound, my commentary, I use this mic right here. It's a Rode VideoMic Me. I actually have to use some bubble wrap to hold it in there. It's a pretty small mic. Obviously, there are a lot better mics out there. Then there's a dead cat filter, and then on top of that, there's a pop filter, which you guys can see. The cord feeds from the mic to my tablet, and then that's where I record my actual commentary. And then once I'm done with that, I email myself that audio from both the computer, which records the game sound, and then the audio from the tablet, which records my commentary, and then I put them all together and render them as one file together on PowerDirector. And that's obviously where I sync up the video and the sound and all that stuff, guys. So there's the entire setup. That's kind of a walkthrough. You guys like my cable management? It's pretty sexy, if I do say so myself. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this, and yeah, let's get back. All right, so first off, in order to record my gameplay, I get AZ Screen Recorder. Obviously, that's what this app is right here. That's what I'm using right now to record, so I'm not gonna be able to go into the app itself. But the settings I have it set up are for it to record to 1080p, 8 megabits per second. I'm not gonna do the 12 because I don't feel like that's necessary, but if you have a really, really high-end device, definitely go 12 because that's gonna improve the quality of your videos. And then I use 30 frames per second. And that's obviously what I use to record my gameplay, and I already told you guys that I record my sound through my computer and through my tablet, and then I email them myself. So that's what I have next is Gmail, and always the files are over 25 megabytes, so I just set them up to download through Google Drive. You can upload and download files that are over 25 megabytes on Google Drive. Just make sure that you delete the files after you're done with them, because they're going to take up a whole lot of space. And then obviously we go on to PowerDirector, and let me show you a little bit of how I edit my videos. Alright, so you might recognize this one right here. This is the intro right here, obviously. And I use all layers that are pretty much possibly available to me in PowerDirector. I'm working on getting PowerDirector on my laptop right now so I can have more layers, because that would just make it super easy. So originally, when I make my first video, like I already told you guys, I have to sync up game sound and my commentary. So before any of this, anything that you see right now, I'm actually just gonna have the raw video, and then two clips of the audio, and that'll be my game audio, and that'll be my commentary. And then I sync those up. Every now and then the gameplay sound gets all messed up, so I have to move it slightly to the right or left or whatever, so that way the gunshots are synced up with the recoil of the rifle, that sort of stuff. And then I have to render that out as an entire video itself. That's a 30-minute video, so that's gonna be a huge file. And that's why a lot of space on my phone is necessary and stuff like that. So that's definitely a must. You need to have a lot of space, because a 30-minute video, 1080p, with 30 frames per second, 8 megabits per second, That's a lot of space. But anyways, once that is all done, then I just have this file right here. And what you're going to see right here is just the plain old, this is a song right here. And then this is the overlay right there. But the video itself has my voice, has the gameplay sound, and has obviously the video all in one file. And that's how I'm able to do technically more than one audio clip per video. It's technically four audio clips. The first one would be my voice, second one would be the game sound, then music, and then sound effects. Alright, so as you guys can see, we have the intro right here, the gameplay right there, as well as my voice and commentary. And then, obviously, for information, just to let you guys know, I just added that as an overlay. And that is just simply done by adding a layer, and you can add anything. There's good old The Office right there. But you have title, you have video, and you have image. So one thing that I have noticed in video is, so I could overlay transparent videos for cool, like, explosion effects and that sort of stuff, but for some reason the chroma key doesn't really work, and it really sucks. But anyways, so here is obviously, okay, it says this isn't found because I already deleted the effect, I don't need it anymore. But this one I use a lot, the no effect.
No!
From The Office right there. I use that a lot. This is not found. That was a Wi-Fi symbol. If you guys watched that video, you guys should watch the video. Link in description. But I have sound effects. So what I do normally is I have music right here, sound effects up here, gameplay, commentary up there, and then every now and then I'll throw in some effects in terms of like random video clips and that sort of stuff. So there's a whole bunch of stuff you can do right here. You can reverse stuff. You can color correct it. In my videos, I always saturate slightly. It's probably not going to show it in here because I do that on the first time that I render the entire video through the 30-minute render. And I usually saturate to about 125-ish. Right now, that's not going to look too good because I've already done that. So, yeah. I try to get rid of all dead silence because it's not very interesting to just watch somebody who's just playing and not talking very much. So, and I also obviously add sound in the background to kind of take care of that if I'm not speaking. PowerDirector is my thing of choice because in KineMaster you have to make like a monthly payment in order to get rid of the watermark or whatever, and PowerDirector is just one simple payment and it's done. So yeah. And now to edit my thumbnails, I use three apps. PS Touch is the most important one, and then you can use either or and Fonto and Pixel Lab. Pixel Lab is good. That's what I used for my banner and profile pic. Those are new, by the way. If you guys like those, let me know in the description below. I really enjoy the way I was able to do that sort of stuff. Anyway, so these are the apps that I use. If I'm going to use Pixel Lab, I'll use that first. Then you just hop in here, just do some random text, and then you go over here to the A. You can mess with different fonts. You can grab different fonts, and the way I do it, I download them from either 1001 Fonts or DaFont. Here's the font that I used for my my banner and stuff. And as you guys can see, sometimes you're gonna have a little bit of it cut off. So what you do is you add a space to see if it, all right, still cut off, and you add another space right there, and there you go, it's not cut off anymore. That's a little trick that I had to learn in order to do that sort of stuff. And then you can mess with color. There's a whole bunch of stuff you could do over here. Gradient, I'm only going to highlight, okay, I don't know, oh, it's because I'm on the wrong text. Hold on a second. There we go, now we're on random. Now we can do the color, and you can assign different colors to different parts. So there you go, you got the green and you have the white. You can obviously make it bigger so you can see it in more detail. Stroke is kind of the outline, and that's what I typically do. It's black, so you can make it bigger, and you can just, there's just so much stuff you can do here. You can make it 3D. it actually looks kind of cool. I try not to go super in depth and that sort of stuff. This kind of gives it like a comic-y type of feel, that sort of stuff. So that gives you the gist of what I do with Pixel Lab right here. And then you actually, if you want it just to be a text file, you go over here to like these I don't know, the double paper thingamajigs, and you go to transparent, and then you save it as a PNG, as an image of PNG. Or if you're not very familiar with Pixel Lab, you can go over here to Fonto, and I'm just going to use this image right here. I'm just going to say Gizmo Shock. Now you can obviously change the fonts. These are the ones that I downloaded. Once again, I'm going to change to that one, and it looks like a good majority of it is cut off. I don't know why that is. All right, so to combat this, I'm just going to go ahead and grab a good old enter in front of there. Hopefully that'll fix it, and indeed it does. And once again, you're going to have to add a couple of spaces at the back of this. So let me go ahead and add another one right there. And let me do one more. Bam. So now we have the entire text right there. Now, here is my favorite part of this app right here, is you can have your own color patterns. The one I use a lot, the yellow that you guys see, is right here. And you can save your own patterns, and then do gradient downward. So as you guys can see, it goes light to dark, and then there's one white, and I'm not really sure why the dog's barking. And then you can go ahead and add a stroke, which is the exact same thing as it was in the other app right there, but there's just not as much you can do in here besides size and opacity. Basically, you can change the color too, obviously. So there's Gizmo Shock in all white, and everything kind of looks a little too close together. So what you can do is mess with the spacing, and you can do the letters or the line. So here's the line that would make stuff move closer or further apart, and then you can also space out the letters, and I'm gonna do it right there. That should be good for the most part. And then I also add a shadow, and I use black. I go down to 1 radius, and that just makes it as dark as possible. As you guys can see, it becomes more blurry as bigger as I go. And then I also go down to 50 so that it's right in the middle, right where it's supposed to be. And then obviously I lower it down a bit so that way you guys can see like that. And there we go, I lowered it too much. Or I can mess with the size. So I'm actually going to cancel here. Size, we're going to go a wee bit bigger. And hold on, let's get this right about there. See, now that looks a little decent. Obviously it doesn't color correlate to the image that I have in the background, but that's the gist of what you guys can see in Fonto. Alright, so here we are in PowerDirector. Now what I normally press is this button down here. It's the image plus, and that obviously opens up your images in any different files that you have them set to. I'm just going to kind of show you guys an example. Let me show. I got a lot of compliments on this one. So right here, I just have many different photo layers. Right here, if I turn this one off, this is the lines. These are all each of the individual lines, which you can download as an image. I actually probably have that. Yes, I do. It's right here. And as you guys can see, the entire background is black, and I did not want that. So I went over to eraser, which I forgot, and then I used one of the settings or whatever to just completely get rid of the black. And normally I don't want them covering the entire screen, so I just kind of widened it out a little bit, and then I made it smaller. And then obviously this is just an image overlay, so is this. I also used eraser to make both of these images, this one right here and the chest one right here that you guys can see, in order to get the character that I wanted. I just wanted the guy. I didn't want any of the background. And then in the background, you guys can see, so I actually have 2 images of these. So if I turn this one off, if I turn this one off, as you guys can see over here at the right, it kind of becomes transparent, and that's a defect of this here effect right here, which is called a directional blur, and that's how I get that effect in the background of that image. So I'm just going to use this image right here as an example. So what I do first is I actually saturate it a bit, so that's how you can get those heavy greens and very light blues, and I don't want to do it too much. I'm just going to keep it right about there, and then I do the directional blur like I told you guys. Just like so, and I do it a pretty decent amount, and as you guys can see, the same effect is happening, the transparency thingamajig. So I have this one back here, and the entire job of turning this one on is to get rid of that, and in order to do that, I just moved it over. So as you guys can see, it's not all the way centered up, and that's because I moved it over to the right a bit, and that is so that way I could actually cover up that side over there. So if I turn these back on, it's completely covered up. And then if I was using Fonto, I would finish this, I would save it right here, then I'll go up here to the save to gallery, I would select it as a PNG. Usually those make, for some reason for me, better quality thumbnails and JPEGs, which I use for my banner and profile picture. But anyways guys, I hope you enjoyed. If you did, make sure to smash the like button, make sure to subscribe if you're new, and I will see you in the next one. See ya, and peace.